Please give a warm Georgia Tech welcome to our guest, Bill Frerking.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Mansoor. I appreciate the introduction, and I'm anxious to meet that guy that's going to speak that has seen it all and done it all. So I look forward to that very much. Before I begin, congratulations to Georgia Tech. I understand Sierra Magazine has listed Georgia Tech as number 8 in its Cool Schools 2013 for sustainability. Good news, huh? And not that anyone's paying attention, but another local school by the name of Emory was ranked 16th, and University of Georgia didn't make the list, so for what it's worth. Now, I also understand they're taping the event today, and I think we should all aspire to be the second video from Georgia Tech to go viral this week. What do you think? Seriously, I appreciate the opportunity to be here. The Impact Series has a great reputation, and I'm honored that you allowed Georgia-Pacific to be a part of it, especially on a topic near and dear to my heart, that's sustainability. You heard the introduction. In a nutshell, I did not grow up wanting to be a chief sustainability officer. I started out doing securities and mergers and acquisition law, moved into becoming an environmental compliance attorney, and then moved to a general counsel and now a chief sustainability officer. In the process, I went from Kansas City, Missouri, to Wichita, Kansas, to St. Simons Island, Georgia, and now to Atlanta. I've represented issuers and underwriters, moved to heavy manufacturing, nuclear waste transportation and Superfund, then to petrochemicals, anhydrous ammonia, cattle feedlots, and asphalt, and now cellulose, pulp and paper, tissue, towel, lumber, and gypsum. My dear wife is Susan. I have 4 children, 2 in college at Baylor and Auburn. One's a football player and one's a basketball player. And I've got 2 still in high school. I've got boys on each end, the girls in the middle. So, and I am thrilled to be here. And now I'd like to tell you a little bit about Georgia-Pacific. Georgia-Pacific has 4 primary businesses. Consumer products, building products, packaging, and a business called GP Harmon Recycling. The consumer products business is comprised of a retail business. Those are the products you see in grocery stores and club channels. GP Professional is another line of business. Those are the largely tissue and towel products you'll see in office buildings, schools, stadiums, and food service products. And then a communication paper, a cut sheet copy paper business. The building products business is comprised of 3 businesses: a wood products business, which is sheathing, plywood, and OSB, dimensional lumber, and engineered lumber. Then there's our gypsum business, which is drywall. And if you guys have driven by buildings under construction and seen that gold sheathing on the outside, that's a Den's Glass Gold, a revolutionary product that Georgia-Pacific invented that is fiberglass. It prevents mold from building up on organics, so leads to better buildings and quicker construction. We have another business that we cleverly call cellulose, container board, and packaging, that's comprised of a cellulose business, container board business, and packaging business. And then, as I said, GP Harmon Recycling. You can see our number of employees, and our tagline is making life's simple necessities. And that's what we do. Here is a picture of where we operate in the United States. And I've limited it to the United States. And the nature of our business lends itself to sustainability. We start with a renewable resource from trees. There are more trees in the United States, more acres of trees, than there were at the 1900. In the last 50 years, there's 25% more trees in America. And if you look at when the Europeans came to America, The loss of acreage to forest is not due to forestry. It's primarily due to urbanization, cities, and agriculture. Why is that important? Because it's companies like Georgia-Pacific that turn trees into dollars. That provides incentive for people to plant and grow trees. And we will only turn them into dollars if they plant them sustainably, grow them sustainably, and harvest them sustainably. And so we believe we play a big role in companies in the forest products businesses like Georgia-Pacific in keeping forestry a viable economic alternative for land in the United States. We also use a lot of biomass fuels. In addition to having our primary feedstock be renewable, about 60% or more of our manufacturing energy comes from renewable biomass. That's a waste and byproduct for us that we could throw away or find alternative uses for, but instead we use for energy. The forest products business is, we believe, the largest user of renewable energy for complex manufacturing in the world. Our products are primarily in two areas, shelter and hygiene, very important areas. Areas that touch people's lives on a daily basis, and we believe make their lives better, from building products, tissue, towel, that clearly promote health and hygiene, to pulp used for feminine hygiene products and disposable diapers and medical devices, to paper that helps you communicate, that you learn to read your first book on, and that you made your first card to your mom and dad on. In fact, it's tough to go through a day without using one of our products or products like ours to make your life better. And then finally, recycling. A little known fact is that last year in the United States, over 65% of all paper manufactured was recovered for recycling. The next closest to that would be metal, and down below that is plastic and glass. Why is paper recovered? Because it's a processed raw material that's valuable and it's traded globally. And those markets provide the economic incentive to recover and use it where it's appropriate. Today, GP is one of the largest tissue manufacturers using recycled fiber in the world. We use about 3 million tons in our own processes. And GP Harmon Recycling, our recovery business, recovers about 7 million tons annually. And we believe one of the benefits of that business and the value it creates to society is connecting high-quality sources of recovered fiber with high-valued end uses. So now, let's think about sustainability. But first, I would like to put it in the business context. So, business 101, why do businesses exist? Well, let's start here. How many of you heard someone say somewhere along the line something to the effect of Walmart put mainstream out of business? Let me see a show of hands. Fair number of you have heard that. Is that true, do you think? If so, how did they do it? And why did they stop with mainstream? In its simplest terms, the question is, what is needed for a business to start and succeed? And in its simplest terms, there are two things. You need an entrepreneur with an idea and a vision who's willing to take risks, but they don't do so well on their own. They need customers who prefer the products and services they provide over the available alternatives in the marketplace. So, as we go back to the question about Walmart putting Main Street out of business, assuming for the sake of this discussion that Main Street is out of business, who did it? And why did they do it? Well, I think the answer to that is lots of folks, really. Why If Walmart opened and shoppers were happy to continue shopping in Main Street, Main Street would still be in business. It was shoppers with dollars that wanted choices that decided they were better served. They had a higher value alternative than what the alternatives they had before Walmart showed up. So, as we think about then why business exists in society, they exist to create value for society. And they fail when they don't create sufficient value. So who gets to decide if they create enough value? Well, again, simply, just for the sake of time, there's a lot of people that play a role in that, a lot of business play a role in that, but there's three groups that have a pretty big impact. One, they're shareholders, right? And if shareholders don't make a profit, or more importantly, if they lose their investment, they're not happy. Now, how does a shareholder lose its investment? Well, if a business takes in more input and the value of those is higher than the value it creates with those input, that's how they lose money. And they're destroying society's resources when they lose money. Profit, again, if we operate in a rule of law, is just a measure that people are creating superior value to the inputs, the human capital, the real property, and the raw materials that they use in a business. There's also customers. We talked about those. The customers have to decide they like your products better than other people. No one has to buy Georgia-Pacific's products. We hope they do. And we hope you'll buy Quilted Northern and Brawny paper towels and Dixie cups and plates and cutlery. And we hope you build lots of houses and buy plywood and OSB and gypsum wallboard. But we're competing to be the best alternative for people that buy products like ours in the marketplace. And then there's governments. Government's role is to make sure people meet minimum society standards as they compete in the business world. So, what does all this really have to do with sustainability? Well, I would suggest it has everything to do with sustainability. I've been at the Koch family of companies for a little over 17 years, and shortly after I showed up, I was in a meeting with Charles Koch, who is the chairman of the company. And I've heard him say something like this many times. This is out of a book that he published a few years ago. Successful companies create value by providing products or services their customers value more highly than available alternatives. They do this while consuming fewer resources, leaving more resources available to satisfy other needs in society. Value creation involves making people's lives better. It is contributing to prosperity in society. Now, he did not make that as an altruistic statement. He made that as a statement of fact to express his view of why he believes business exists and why they're successful. And when I was approached at the end of 2007 about taking this role, I sat down with our CEO, and he said, Bill, we'd like you to consider taking this role. What do you think? And since I hadn't attended such a fine academic school as Georgia Tech, I thought for a second, and I said, well, what do you want me to do? And without smiling and responding, he goes, well, that's what we want you to figure out. And so as I went in search to try to say, well, okay, what is sustainability, and how should we use it, and what does it look like when we see it, I kind of went back to this statement on value creation and realized that if you change one word, successful to sustainable, I pose that you've got as fine a working definition of sustainability as there could be. Because sustainability is not about always doing more with less. I would venture that if we could take our pulp mills that make tissue and create a cure for cancer, except it used 10 times the wood and 10 times the energy and 10 times the emissions for each dose of cancer treatment. That it would be sustainable, the most sustainable thing we could do, to go to market with the cure and trust the market that they will drive efficiencies over time in those processes. And so it's about what? Creating value through choices while consuming fewer resources. Why? Because that leaves more resources available to satisfy other needs in society. And at the end of the day, it's about making people's lives better. Again, not because it's a noble cause. That is a fine reason to do it. But I would venture to say that for most business, the most sustainable reason to do it is your competitors will beat your brains out if you're not very good at it. And if you don't stop to think, why do people buy our stuff and think it's better than the other stuff like ours they can buy, that you're missing the first big opportunity in sustainability. Well, in an effort to make that factual statement something real that GP can use in everyday businesses, we created what we call the sustainability framework. And this is it. So again, not being a Georgia Tech grad, I thought I could draw a picture on a PowerPoint and we'd have the answer, and it didn't work so well. But it was a good start. Because what this teaches us is that when we talk about sustainability, we must do it in three dimensions. Any one or two of those dimensions are fine to focus on and talk about, but unless you're talking about all three, you're not having a sustainability discussion. Because when we look at these three dimensions, well recognized, we didn't create these. These are straight out of the Brundtland Commission and a whole bunch of work ever since then. What we said is, look, our job is to understand the social benefits and drawbacks to our operations and products in society. And we want to maximize the benefits and minimize the drawbacks. Now, we can do that. And the first thing you have to ask in social is, how do our products, especially a particular product, make people's lives better? And that's helping people's lives be better through the products we make, supporting our communities. There's a whole bunch of things in there, especially when you get into human rights, dealing in countries that don't have the rule of law and the social structure that we have in the developed world. So it's not easy, but that's where you look through the lens to find those issues. The second dimension is environmental. That's using resources wisely, complying with laws, minimizing waste. And the third dimension is economics. That has to do with cost, that has to do with profitability, that has to do with the competitiveness of our products in the marketplace. And the goal of looking at those issues in these three dimensions is to create value through the optimal balance of the factors in those three dimensions. Because if you try to maximize the value in any one or two, you do it to the detriment of the others. And what you find is your products are no longer acceptable in the marketplace. Now, this is a mental model. And what a mental model does is take complexity and make it manageable to where we can make decisions about it. There are some phenomenal models that don't always work very well, like weather models, right? They're very sophisticated. They just aren't very good and accurate at handling all the complexity that determines whether you can have your wedding outside on Saturday or not. So we think that this model, this framework, actually captures what the marketplace is doing in a series of very complex decisions. So let's look at a few examples of this inaction by playing a game that I call sustainable or not. All right, so show of hands. If you're having a cup of coffee, who thinks a permanent ceramic cup is more sustainable than a paper cup? Let's see hands for permanent. Let's see hands for paper. All right. Well, if you go back to this framework, the question is, why? What do people want out of a coffee cup? I would venture that it's very different if you're sitting at a French restaurant with tablecloths, you just got engaged, they just brought out the souffle, you're gazing lovingly into your fiancé's eyes, and the waiter says, can I get you a cup of coffee? In that situation, you'd probably prefer what? Porcelain. Why? Aesthetics. Image. Right? You don't mind if your finger's a little too big for the little hole and that, you know, they have to fill it up a lot. You're not there to drink coffee. But if you're running out the door to work, getting on MARTA or hopping in your car to fight Atlanta traffic, what do you want to have in your hand? Why? Convenience. You got more of it. It'll keep it warm longer. And I would say there's also a hygiene difference. Have you ever gotten a paper coffee cup with lipstick stains on it? Mm-mm. So in asking the question of which is more sustainable, we wanted to get some facts in the environmental dimension, because what we find is that people tend to, since they're involved in the disposal of paper food service products, they tend to believe they have a negative impact on the environment. So we did a study. It's called a life cycle assessment. And there's international standards, an ISO standard for doing a couple of them, LCA standards. And what we learned is that the paper cup is superior from an environmental standpoint to the ceramic cup until the fourth use of the ceramic cup between washings. So, think about that. If it's the coffee cup on your desk, that's probably okay with you. But if you're customer 2, 3, 4, or 5 in the restaurant, that's not so okay with you. Now, what people fail to think about is that in this trade-off, one's from a renewable resource, the other's from a depleting resource. They also often fail to take into account the water, the heat, the energy of washing those over and over, which is part of the equation. Let's take another one. Paper. Virgin paper from new trees or recycled paper? Which is more sustainable? Well, I won't make you do a show of hands again this time. But it's not really an either-or question. We are a large manufacturer of virgin products, paper, tissue, towel, and recycle. And we like both. And there are trade-offs in uses. The big problem often in recycling is when there are content mandates. So states or businesses or governments decide they want to mandate a percent content of recycled material. Because in that situation, what it often does is accentuates the inefficiency of where paper is collected to where it has to go to be manufactured and where it has to go to be sold. The market is very efficient at those trade-offs. It prices them in. Paper is traded on a global market. The price setter in the world is China. So for a manufacturer in the US to use a ton of recovered paper, they typically outbid China in the marketplace. So there's two reasons people usually like recycled paper. One, because they want to keep paper out of landfill. Well, we already talked about that over 65% of it was recovered of all grades of paper manufactured in the United States. And when you think about it, all your notebooks, the books on your shelf, you don't buy a book to read it and then recycle it. You don't get photographs printed to look at them and recycle them. There are boxes you have that are still doing their purpose of storing stuff for you. So there's a lot of paper that's meeting its intended use, plus tissue and towel that a lot of which we don't really want to recover and reuse, right? So when you think about what the top end of that market is, 65%, we're diving pretty deep in the dumpster as an industry right now to get a paper, right? So for people to say, well, I want to use recycle because I want to collect more, I would say that's not really driving up collection rates. Alternatively, you hear people say they want to save a tree. Well, we talked about that China's the price setter in the world, so just in simplest terms, if we use a ton of paper in the U.S., then we're not saving a tree, we're just shifting it from being harvested here and among the most sustainable forestry basins in the world to being cut for use in China, which comes from a lot of sources, but the most likely ones are China, Russia, and Indonesia. And I would say those are among some of the more questionable forestry basins in the world. So again, the facts of sustainability sometimes don't match the perceptions. Now, we also did a life cycle assessment on virgin and recycled. And actually, this one surprised all of us, I think, a little bit. While we thought it would be relatively close, because where does recycled paper come from? Virgin paper, right? Recycled paper grows on trees, just like regular paper. And so there is a burden that has to be borne by the recovered fiber because it just didn't go from tree to recovered paper. So when we looked at the life cycle assessment for that, and others have done this as well, what they basically find is that virgin paper is actually beneficial in fossil fuel impacts, which would be greenhouse gases and global warming potential. It's typically how that's nominated in LCAs. In water quality, and in water quality, recycled is favored in human toxicity and in the rest of the, parameters, basically water use and solid waste, there was no significant difference between the two. So whether you prefer virgin or recycled paper products, have no fear. They both have their place, and you can feel very good using either one of them. Now, what's all that leading Georgia-Pacific to think about and do? Well, one of our businesses has historically had a sales value proposition go to market that looked like this. They would talk about these factors to their customers. Cost and use, sustainability, hygiene, image, productivity. And over the last few years, what they've realized is all those are factors in sustainability. And instead of going to market with sustainability as a topic, they could go to market and offer sustainable solutions across a portfolio and allow the customers to decide what attributes in their products in our portfolio that they like the best. And so what ends up happening is all the same things get talked about, but now you make more transparent for customers what the trade-offs are in their products, and that should give us greater visibility into what they value most in our portfolio, and likewise what they don't value that should be an opportunity for us to improve. So a couple of quick examples of this in action. I think it's a pretty powerful chart right here. This chart, and I'm going to be a little circumspect on this one, so bear with me. This shows two classes of commodity products that Georgia-Pacific makes. They are true commodities, and in the marketplace, very hard to distinguish not only across our portfolio, but among our competitors' portfolio, which means they often sell based on what? Price, cost, right? Price to the user. Well, by focusing on these sustainability attributes, and delivering attributes that our customers preferred, we created advantaged products in two categories across those commodity lines. And what this chart shows is that our percent of profits for both categories is more than two times in excess of what the volume of sales would predict. And that's with our data, not compared to the general marketplace. So what we conclude from that is that if sustainability is valuable in the market, and if, in a disciplined fashion, we try to determine what the marketplace values most, and if we deliver better alternatives to the marketplace, that we can take, even in a commodity space, we can create advantage products. Now, I'll give you a real life example that hopefully you guys are familiar with. Hopefully by now everyone has seen and used an in-motion dispenser. I encourage you to wave your hand in front of there a few hundred times when you go into a bathroom. But this is interesting. And I've got to tell you a little story. One of the people that hired me years ago in my career, when I had the opportunity to go to the first piece of the forest products business, I had the misfortune of telling my family we had to move from Wichita, Kansas to St. Simons Island, Georgia. But he called and he said, "Hey, I hear you're taking a new job." And I said, "Yeah." And he said, "Well, what are you going to do?" And I said, "Well, I'm going to go with these business." And he said, "Well, don't they make like stuff for diapers and toilet paper and hand towels?" He said, "That's not very sexy, right?" And it was actually interesting because really it's just the opposite. When we sell pulp, our pulp sells on every continent in the world that has paper machines. And you know, you can see every emerging market through pulp sales. You know why? Because shoppers in most societies are women. And when they can have access to feminine hygiene products and disposable diapers with enough income to get it, it immediately makes their lives better. So here's my lesson for all the students out there. You think working at Apple's cool? And you know what? It may be. But when you make stuff that people use in their lives every day and it makes a real difference, don't think about it as a boring old business. Think about it as an opportunity to add value and improve lives in society. So that's what we did here. What happens when you go into the bathroom? Go into the bathroom, for whatever reason, you wash your hands, and then you're faced with what dilemma? Yeah, you want to touch that yucky thing that who knows who else was in there touching. Or worse, remember the old cloth towels that you pulled down and they were damp and you weren't really sure what happened with them? Yuck, right? I mean, that's not fun. Or the air dryers. Who likes those? That's like 1,000 people sneezing in the bathroom without covering their mouths over and over, right? I mean, that's kind of gross. So we said, look, they just washed their hands. What's a social dilemma? They just washed their hands. Their hands are clean. They don't want to touch something dirty. What do we do about it? I wonder if we can make a towel that's touchless. Okay, well, let's do that. Well, wait a minute. You can't make a towel that's... We make towel. We can't make a towel that's touchless. We want them to touch it. That's how they dry their hand. So we had to focus on what? A dispenser. Well, we don't know anything about dispensers. So it took someone stopping and thinking outside the box. So then what we did with that dispenser is we controlled two things. Actually, three. One, there's no towel showing. So the towel stays more hygienic, waiting to be used. Number two, we can control the portion of towel they get. And number three, we can control how fast it recharges. So guess what you do then? You eliminate waste. I know none of you have ever done it, but with four kids, there's times you go in and you just grab a chunk and pull as hard as you can, and some fall out on the floor, but you know, it's a bloody nose or a milkshake all over somewhere or whatever it is. And that's waste. And that happens over and over and over again. So guess what we could show? compared to the traditional three-fold towel, we can save 20 to 30% towel uses for our customers. Guess what that means to them? They buy less towels, right? And guess what? Here's a little secret. All the places where you go and wash your hands, none of them are in business to wash your hands. That's a cost. It's a service, an ancillary service they're providing. We can save them money. And guess what we can also do, back to the environmental dimension, that's less waste going out the door. And if you back it up, that's less towels in the supply chain, that's less stocks for them, that's less turns where employees have to stop and recharge one of those things and put something in it. And now we have a value proposition to go to the market that's sold on what? Did we create a better towel? Okay, I think we did. And in fact, we now have. And now we can give you a towel, we can give you a bleached, we can give you an unbleached. We can give you certified, uncertified, we can give you one with a pattern on it, not a pattern on it. We can give you a thicker one or a thinner one. But what we delivered is a more sustainable solution to an everyday occurrence. And I would say, maybe it's just me, but the first time I saw one of those and I didn't work for Georgia-Pacific, I did it like four or five times because I just thought it was kind of cool, the little sound it made, you know? So, that's sustainability in action. Now, let me just close, and then I'll take some questions with a few things. What do I see as challenges in sustainability? I actually see a lot. Because what I've just told you about sustainability, I would not say that's a common view of sustainability by most businesses in the United States or in the world. And I think you can see that by businesses tend to look at sustainability as a way to use less to make more. And as you know, there's a piece of that that we agree with. But I would also suggest that when Apple came out with the iPhone, and I don't know this, I haven't looked at the data, but I believe that it had to use more raw materials, more rare earths, and more energy to make an iPhone than any other prior phone. But when the marketplace voted by what phone they chose, there was one that they so far have thought overwhelmingly is the most sustainable choice to fulfill their needs. Now that's changing. And if you've seen what Samsung's done, it's pretty interesting what's going on in that market. So I say that to set up some of these challenges. One, a prescribed view of sustainability. By that I mean, we have a lot of customers that come in and they want us to do a certain thing that they say is most sustainable. And, you know, they may or may not be right. I would tell you oftentimes we struggle with the thing they want us to maximize because we are very aware of the second and third order effects if the market goes in that direction. And so, as with my porcelain and paper analogy or my virgin recycled, the facts matter in this. Because this isn't about wanting to do good, it's in fact what impacts do we have on society and creating value and using resources wisely. Two, narrow focus. When people say, hey, sustainability for us is about these four things, I immediately think of all the thousands of other things out there. How did you get those four? Now, you got to have priorities. You can't do everything. But I would also venture to say sustainability is not an absolute truth. And I'll give you an example. If you're a Georgia Tech student and you've got a choice to head off to college in a Prius or a four-wheel drive Suburban, what do you think best serves your needs at Georgia Tech? Well, it's probably not a universal answer. But I would suggest for a lot of students, Prius takes less gas. You can't haul as many people, so you don't get stuck driving the big group all the time. It's easier to park, right? But now, you go with your friends on spring break, and you're at the top of the mountain getting good powder, and you break your leg, and you call for the ambulance. What do you want to show up, Prius or the Suburban? It depends. Situations change. Resources that are scarce in some areas are plentiful in others. Saving water is not the same everywhere. If you're on the headwater of the Mississippi River, and 90% of your water is one-time pass-through, and you discharge it without creating any quality issues, you might be highly inefficient, but other than operating cost, who cares? Because you're not depriving anybody of water. That's a very different answer if you're in arid southwest Georgia operating a facility. So be careful to narrow focused issues and one size fits all. Government intervention. And I'll say this, this isn't to say government intervention is bad. The problem is it's almost always one size fits all, and it is slow to respond. And so what happens is a minimum expectation set and innovation and competition around that almost come to a grind. It's happened over and over with environmental innovation. And I'm not saying that's bad. I just don't think it's the best way to get the results in sustainability. Because once the government says thou shalt not, in my view, it's no longer sustainable. It's compliance. And it's about optimizing around the constraint, not creating a better solution. And then I think the whole issue of transparency, you hear about transparency. The fact is there's a lot of transparency that, look, there is so much data in our business, it's hard for those of us in the business to really get meaningful information out of the data sometimes. And I would venture to say that a lot of the information being asked for in the area of sustainability is a good check-the-box exercise, but it may not be that helpful to business decisions. And there is a cost every time information is provided. And that ends up coming back to consumers in the marketplace. So the whole transparency movement, and again, I'm not saying these are bad, I'm just saying these are challenges that I see coming up. And last but not least, supply chain accountability. Do I believe there needs to be a supply chain accountability? Yes, I do. We have expectations for our suppliers, just like we hope our customers have expectations for us. But when you start trying to expand the role of a business to, in essence, be an insurer of non-affiliated businesses that they're just in a contractual relationship with, there are not only significant legal issues around that, but it's very difficult to think about when that stops. And I'll just give you one example to leave you with. As you think about an issue like child labor, very serious issue. I would also venture that anyone who ever babysat for someone on their street or at their church when they were 13 or 14 or 15 or mowed their yard engaged in child labor in that transaction. Now, it's not forced labor. So why do we think it's okay to hire the neighbor kid to watch our child while we go out on an anniversary date, my wife and I? A responsible neighbor kid. And we pay them. But we set an arbitrary standard in a foreign land that there's a certain age above which you cannot work. When you're with your dad and mom on the family forest or the family farm or whatever it is. I am not saying those are easy issues. I'm saying when we really look at how to benefit societies and protect rights and act with integrity, the issues can become cloudy. And it gets tough sitting in a developed country in air-conditioned offices, drinking coffee, hopefully out of paper cups, drying our hands in a sanitary condition, and really think through all the implications of some of these supply chain issues brewing around. So, business 101 and sustainability all in however much time. I am happy to take some questions.
Yeah, Bill, there's a question just right up here.
Hi. Big question I have for you, it relates to some of the challenge points that you laid out and how they interact with each other, specifically supply chain accountability versus the fact that you do have some very different views on how you're arriving at your sustainability calculations, for lack of a better word. So do you, the prescribed views. So if they have a different view from yours, how do you force them into accountability, realizing they have other customers without turning it into, as you said, a sustainability versus a compliance issue?
No, that's an excellent question. And I listed those as challenges because I don't have great answers for a lot of them. You know, here's what I'd say, and you touched on some of it. First of all, most of our suppliers have many other customers. Now, as Georgia-Pacific, we're a little bit unique. We are a very integrated company. We are the only, I believe, tissue and towel company in the United States that still operates pulp mills. So we buy our trees here. We know where they come from. We know the supply chain. We get them into our mills, right? And we have that part of the process. A lot of people are buying pulp from different places in the world. Now, we buy some pulp, too. But it's just not a big percentage of our overall fiber need. But when you start looking at things like, I'll tell you one, we have companies, large, responsible name brand companies that say, hey, we're going to send you our supplier guidelines and principles, and we want you to agree with these, we want you to post them in your plants, we want to train your employees on them, and we want the ability to audit you unannounced when we want. Well, that's one of those that sounds good sitting in a conference room. But we may have a box plant or a tissue plant that has thousands of customers. How many of those can we do that for before we become Disney World and do guided tours through our plants, right? And how many sets of standards can we actually train our employees on, right? And so I think there are better ways. I think too often what businesses do is, and what I challenge ours to do is, let's not just look at what makes our life easy. Let's look at what are we trying to achieve, and let's look at the alternatives for trying to get that result and see how we can do that, right? There are some parts of the world where we, 100% of the time, when we go in and have a new vendor, we will send people in there and we will assess their facility before we'll even sign the agreement as part of the negotiations. There are other parts of the world, like in the United States, mostly Western Europe, where we may or may not do that. Why? Because we trust the institutions of society and the rule of law that we're not going to find slave labor, forced labor, you know, the kind of violations that you just don't want to be a part of in other parts of the world. So some societies, they have those structures in place, and you can take some confidence. And that's not a blank check. That's not saying we don't have responsibility. But just try to find the end point of where that responsibility is and how far do we go and how many resources do we put toward that. Those are tough issues.
I have a question for you. First of all, thanks very much for coming in today. And I think you laid out an excellent case for the sustainability of Georgia-Pacific's products when you consider the total cost of production and total cost of usage. I think you've also talked a little bit about fair labor as well, but could you also explain what perhaps programs you've introduced or been introduced over the last few years within Georgia-Pacific that deals with sustainability in your processes? You know, for example, what are you doing regarding air quality and water quality? And I'm not sure if you have like paper mills or not as part of your networks, but paper mills can be pretty smelly and things like that. So are you guys doing things just internally?
Well, you think they're smelly?
Well, the ones I've been around, especially the ones that where you're breaking down the pulp.
But you know what's interesting about that, by the way? That's called non-combustible gases that you smell, right? So you can't burn them and get rid of them. One of just the interesting asides, when I talked about government regulation, one of the kind of second order effects of government regulation, they required you to collect all those. The problem is now if you have any malfunction in that collection system, they're so concentrated that the odor goes in a hurry. I mean, it's just a new set of problems to try to deal with. But you asked, first of all, energy management, okay? Most people don't realize that the U.S. is the world leader in reducing greenhouse gases as a percentage of GDP. The world leader, right? Now, did the economy have something to do with that? Yep. Did fracking and nat gas coming on have something to do with that? Yep. But guess what else had to do with it? High energy cost, right? As energy costs get higher, what do businesses say? We got to start wasting less energy. So now it's worth it to go look for that next tranche. And without widespread greenhouse gas legislation and regulation, the U.S. leads the world. So, you know, I think that's an example of the marketplace acting very rationally and efficiently. In our energy management program, I'll just give you broad terms if I can. And you know, you got to take pricing volatility out of it, and with the economics up and down, what you're running, what rate you're running, all that. But in big numbers, we'll buy on average $1.2 billion plus or minus in purchased energy. Okay. And that's with over half of our manufacturing energy being biomass is not included in there, right? So we started looking at what we, a few years ago, 2 years after I got in this role, at what can we do to better manage energy and capture those quality projects and leverage learnings. And we have kicked off a program that we think we will be somewhere down around, I think in the first full 3 years, we're about 7.5% down, comparing comparables in energy use on an intensity basis. So we're very happy with that. We do not handicap projects. They compete for capital like every other project. Now, obviously, there are some projects, if we're saving money, we feel like there's less risk. We'll take a little bit lower return than if you're investing in something new, you got a lot more risk. But we don't handicap it and say, you know, we'll accept very low return sustainability projects. We just don't do that. So there's one. On a case-by-case basis, we've done things in mills, especially around water in areas of curtailment. In some cases where we've run for 4 to 6 months at like 30% of the normal water a facility will run with. Now, there are consequences to that that probably don't make it beneficial to do long term. But, you know, back a couple of years ago, it's hard to believe this year where it feels like Seattle around here. But, you know, when water was short, there were a number of facilities that we need to really look at water use because the area was being impacted and we were trying to do our part and cut back. And then in forestry, I mean, we do a lot of forestry initiative, a lot of trainers of forestry because that's pretty key to us. And the last one I'll say is on the supply chain, we introduced supplier sustainability purchasing guidelines where we basically said, here's our minimum expectation. And we're gonna start assessing our suppliers according to this set of guidelines and try to move our suppliers up and to the right in terms of their performance across three dimensions. And we did it in three dimensions, social, environmental, and economic.
Were these programs a result of setting up this directive
system? It really is. I mean, you know, it's like anything. Who's going to own it? And you know, it's kind of like if in the old remediation model at facilities, you had people kind of spending 3:30 to 5 o'clock on Thursday afternoon stopping their operation roll and talking about remediation. And so you probably never really got expertise in it. You never got really good because you didn't see the problem a second, third time. So that's what happened. Our businesses were doing it independently. They wanted to bring it together. And so by creating the role, we now have a corporate capability that's only about six people. And then We created some positions in the business that would have decision rights within those businesses and capabilities so that we know who owns it in that area. There's probably another 55 to 60 people company-wide in those roles and subject matter roles. And so that's our effective sustainability organization.
Bill, we've got two more questions, and that'll be the end. So I'm just going to pass this one and then that last one over there.
First, thank you for speaking to us. You spoke a lot about market forces being the primary, one of the key drivers of sustainability. Mm-hmm. Have you ever had a specific example of maybe social and ethical responsibility taking precedence over market forces and driving your sustainability?
I guess, can you give me an example? I mean, I'm trying to understand, because the way we would look at it is not market forces. We don't look at market forces in the economic dimension. Now, the fact of the matter is, in business, right, the equation, the right side of the equal signs is always dollars, right? That's how we make decisions. It's not like life. You know, I don't walk into my kid's birthday party and go, I love you, here's $50, right? I mean, I give him a hug and a kiss, say, Dad's proud of you, right? That's a currency in that. If I did that after a business meeting, I would probably have a lawsuit filed against me, right? So, it's kind of funny, but I mean, it's just true, right? There, value is always subjective, right? I mean, it's amazing the way the market works. So when we think about market forces, we want the market forces playing in all three dimensions. And what we advocate is let's drive competition so that if you all are customers, consumers, or end users, you tell us what you like. Now, don't just tell us. We're going to watch how you act with your dollars, right? Because people say they value a lot of things, but when you watch them, they don't seem to value it very much, right? So we pay attention to that. We want to compete in that marketplace because we think we compete with the best in the world in that marketplace. But when there start becoming constraints, mandates, laws, things that may work in some situation, not other, you just thwart innovation, and it's harder to really distinguish yourself in the business world. Does that? I don't think that gets your question. So let me give you another shot at.
Well, I was just wondering if it was less profitable and less economically feasible, but you guys still chose to make a decision that was more socially responsible or ethically relevant.
Yeah. So. I won't give you a real specific because just for liability reasons, right? But we sometimes find issues along the line of, say, hearing loss in manufacturing facilities where there's a lot of noise, people don't wear PPE, and a lot of other parts of the world, personal protective equipment isn't either very good or very available. We have in a couple of situations I know of in the last 2 years gone into places like that and really sat down and talked about changes and what our alternatives are in moving business, right? A lot of places work hours get really long, and especially in Asia, and going in and saying, if you're going to work on our stuff, we want to limit the weeks of people that work on our stuff. Now, what we're finding, surprisingly, that sounded like a good solution, but those people are taking time off on our stuff and then literally going to a plant across the street because they want to keep working. So it didn't quite work out the way we wanted it to, but you know, you got to set some limits. And what we think on that is when you say, will we trade off the economic dimension? We don't think long-term we're trading off that dimension. We think long-term, that's the most valuable place for our business to be. Now, the future will determine whether we're right or not. We don't have a crystal ball. So we may take a short-term hit because we think long-term it's the most valuable place for our business. Does that get it? Thanks.
Just this last question over here.
Yeah, I was wondering, do you find that your sustainable product innovations ever come out of a focus on sustainability, or are they more a byproduct of focusing on fixing other problems like your in-motion towel dispenser?
Yeah, just from where we are right now, I mean, a lot of the examples I'd give you, people weren't sitting around saying, well, what is sustainability telling us to do? Because when these products were being developed, coming to market, no one was using that term, right? But I think as the slide that showed the sales framework, you know, and talking about kind of five topics that they would run through versus a sustainability framework, I think what we're seeing and what the businesses are seeing is they didn't call it sustainability, and they don't always think about it as sustainability. What they're coming to the realization is the reality it is sustainability. They've just been balancing those trade-offs as kind of one-off and not being very disciplined at trying to understand the impacts in the three dimensions, right? And so what they're starting to do is embrace those tools to say, okay, this gives, it's not magic fairy dust. It doesn't tell you the right answer, right? But it just gives you a disciplined, repeatable way to say, as we're making bets, I mean, if you think about sustainability, sustainability is a future condition we're all trying to achieve, right? And we're doing it making decisions today about our actions tomorrow to try to be sustainable in the future. So as you're doing that, you need some tools to say, gosh, there's a whole gob of stuff that we've got to get right. We've got to hit the spec on our product, right? We've got to have feedstocks. If it's raining, it's hard to get in forest. We've got to have wood. You know, what can we? What are our backup plans? All these things. But when you balance them, it comes down to, what are customers, consumers, and end users going to buy? What do they want? And what do they want us to minimize in the products we're delivering? And I think it's that focus. If you look at kind of where we are right now organizationally, we're kind of getting that risk piece coming into focus, and I think it's helping us there. I think we've got some more opportunity to kind of move up and say, okay, how can we use this to really create advantage? Because frankly, those don't come along that often. You know, especially, you know, we're not an IT company that's constantly rolling out new products. That's not what we've traditionally been. So, we are doing some things, and we're doing some things that are extensions. So for example, we really looked at, on InMotion when it came out, it's been very popular. But we started looking at, okay, how are we making that cabinet, and what's happening to those dispensers after they get old in the marketplace, right? So a couple of years ago, we kicked off a dispenser recovery program where we take them back, right? And that made us rethink, okay, how are they manufacturing these so that we can recover them easier? Not only materials that are more recyclable and have value on the other end, but that we can take them apart more efficiently and get them to recycling and reuse, right? So, you know, that process, I don't think, you're never there. You know, it's something we keep working on. So I would like to tell you that we're really good at it, but we're working hard at it every day and we can get a lot better.
Okay, Bill, I just wanted to thank you on behalf of the Georgia Tech community for coming to talk to us. Can I get a round of applause for Bill, please?